Hi all, and welcome to yet another video in a statistical software and criminal justice course. This video will be about regression and SPSS. I will use the same data set that I used in the correlation video. You can check it out. And that is the violent crime and poverty. The data is taken from UCR and American Community Survey. So what is regression? Regression is the next step to the correlation. The correlation only tested the supported relationship between two numerical variables. And that was pretty much what we could do. We could not find any causation using correlation. But with regression, we can figure out a little bit more. We can even predict what is the value of the dependent variable B given a known value in the independent variable or the predictor. So what does the null and alternative hypothesis in regression tests look like? Keep in mind that with this data set that we have here, violent crime and poverty, the main research question is that poverty causes crime. Okay, so what is the null hypothesis in regression? The null hypothesis will state that the variation in the poverty percentage, which is one of the variables here, is unrelated to the variation in violent crime rate. Or we can state it another way, the correlation between poverty percentage and violent crime rate is zero, which is sort of the same as the correlation null hypothesis. Or we can say that there is no supported relationship between poverty percentage and violent crime rate. However, I do have a preference, and my preference for the null hypothesis in regression is that there is no statistically significant relationship between the poverty percentage and violent crime rate. The alternative hypothesis will be that there is a statistically significant relationship between poverty percentage and violent crime rate. So let's look at that. One of the parameters that we're going to figure out in the regression is B, which is the regression coefficient or the slope, otherwise called the rise over the run. And when we talked about that the correlation between the independent and dependent variable is zero, we meant that the regression slope is going to be zero, or B is going to be zero. We're going to look at the regression table in just a moment. So what do we do in SPSS? How do we do the regression test in SPSS? We go to Analyze, click on it, and the menu drops down, and then we have to go all the way down to the regression, and then click on Linear. Now, the linear regression dialog box looks a little bit different from the correlation dialog box. The linear regression has a dependent field and an independent field, and they represent the dependent variable and the independent variable. Now, we do know that because of the research question is poverty causes crime, the poverty is the predictor and crime is the outcome or the dependent variable. So what is the independent variable here going to be? We're going to look at poverty percent. So let's look at that by taking it and dragging it into the independent field. And then we're going to look at the violent crime rate. We're going to select that variable, click on the arrow to put it in the dependent field. Now we have a bunch of options here. I'm just going to go to statistics to get some simple descriptives, such as the mean, median, standard deviation of the two numerical variables. The confidence interval is always good to get at 95% interval, which corresponds to our alpha of 5%, which is the significance level at which we're going to test the null hypothesis. We're going to click Continue. And we're not going to get anything else. Just click OK. Now, the regression generally has four tables, but when we ask for descriptives, we get another. And that is right here on the top. Descriptive statistics gives us a mean of 39.7 violent crime rate and 12.3 percent of families living below poverty line. These are the standard deviations, and we do have a sample size of 51. We do have 50 states plus District of Columbia. Now, looking at the correlations, we actually looked at this before in the correlation video. You can check it out on the other video. The Pearson correlation coefficient between a violent crime rate and a poverty percentage was 0.481, and that was a somewhat strong relationship with a significance of less than 0.001. So the correlation was actually a significant test. Looking at the other variable, we have the dependent variable, violent crime, of course. The variables entered, that signifies the independent variable, which is a poverty percentage. The model summary, you have two values here that are very important. First is the R correlation coefficient that we saw up here in the correlations table, and the R square. I just talked briefly about R square in the correlation video, but that basically is the R value squared, and that is 0.231. Translate that into percentage, that's going to be 23.1%. And what does that represent? 23.1% represents the amount of variation in the dependent variable, which is violent crime rate, that is explained by the variation in the independent variable, which is poverty percentage. So poverty percentage variation in the data explains 23.1%, or about a quarter of the variation in violent crime rate. That means that 75% is unexplained or explained by other variables. So if we add more predictors, that R square or coefficient of determination is going to increase, meaning that more predictors will explain more of the variation in the outcome. Let's leave ANOVA for a moment, because we're going to talk about that in the ANOVA video. But just look at the significance here is the same as the correlation significance that you saw up there. The most important table in the regression test is the coefficients. There are a few things that we need to look at here. The first thing is the constant. The constant is also called the intercept, okay? The unstandardized coefficient, or the B value here, is -4.504. And what is this? This is the intercept, which means that this is the predicted value in the dependent variable, which is violent crime rate, when poverty percentage is zero. So if poverty percentage is zero, you are not going to have any violent crime. In this case, it's a negative number, which doesn't make any sense, but this is for the purposes of the regression equation that we're going to construct later on. What is the value 3.601? That is the regression coefficient, or the slope, or rise over the run. What does that represent? It means that for every 1 unit in increase in the independent variable, which is poverty percent, so for 1% increase in poverty level, you're going to have 3.6 units of increase in violent crime rate. Okay, so these are the associated standard errors. And then you have the standardized coefficient, the beta. What is this 0.481? 0.481 sort of has the same interpretation as the 3.601B value, but the interpretation differs in that for every one standard deviation increase, not 1 unit increase, the unit of measurement for a percent of families living below poverty level was percentage, right? So before we said for 1% increase. In this case, with 0.481 is for one standard deviation increase in poverty level, you'll have 0.48, or half a standard deviation increase in the violent crime rate. You have the associated T value, which is the statistics that makes all this significance possible. And what do we see here? The significance is smaller than 0.001. As you can see, these significances are kind of the same in the ANOVA table in the correlation significance testing, and over here as well. And what does that mean? It's that we reject the null hypothesis of no relationship or no statistical relationship between poverty percentage and violent crime rate, and we accept the alternative hypothesis. In other words, we can say that the sample provides enough evidence of a statistically significant relationship between poverty percentage and violent crime rate. And as you can see here, this is supported by p-value, but at the same time, it's supported by the confidence interval as well. And what does this mean? It means that the true regression coefficient is going to fall between 1.7 and 5.5. And that does not cross zero, so one is not negative and the other is positive, which means that it might not be significant. And because it doesn't cross zero, the regression coefficient, it's always going to be positive, which means that with the increase of the independent variable, you're going to see an increase in the dependent variable or violent crime rate. So all is good here. And one other thing that we need to do is, because this test shows significance, we're going to construct the regression equation. So the regression equation usually is y, or dependent variable, equals a, which is the constant, plus b times independent variable, and plus some sort of error that we can't really measure. Here's a question. What is, for example, the violent crime rate predicted to be when the percent of families below poverty level reaches 25%? Okay, we can just substitute 25 for x, and then we can get the value of the dependent variable that is going to be predicted with the dependent variable being 25%, and that is going to be 85.5 violent crimes per 10,000 people, or the violent crime rate is going to be 85.5. Now, one thing that I want to mention here is that the poverty percent that we set out as 25% in order to predict what the violent rate is going to be when poverty percentage is 25 might not work all the time and might give us bigger error, because the number 25 or value 25 in poverty percent is not found in the sample. It's not found in the model. So sometimes the model works perfectly when values are between the minimum and the maximum of what we see here. And what we see here is that there is no 25. We can figure out that quickly by going to analyze descriptive statistics, and then we're going to get the, for example, frequencies in the statistics. We're going to get the minimum and maximum of poverty percentage and see if 25 is there. Minimum is 7 and maximum is 19. So 25 is not there. That means that because the predicted value is not within the model, the outcome may not be totally reliable. So keep that in mind. One other thing that I wanted to show you is multiple regression. More times than not, there's not going to be one predictor for whatever outcome that you wish to learn. In this case, it's the same. Maybe SNAP percentage or maybe unemployment percentage also add to the power of predicting violent crime rate, in addition to the poverty percentage. As we saw, poverty percentage explains only about 25% of the variation. What if we add these other two? What do we see? How do we do a multiple regression? Multiple linear regression is the same procedure as the bivariate regression. We can go to analyze regression, linear, and then when you see block one of one, and if you remember this was the independent, we can add more predictors or more variables that we think will be good fit to predict the outcome. So let's add SNAP percentage and let's add unemployment percentage. Now there are many ways or many methods that we can do this. We're going to leave enter, but there are also stepwise remove, which removes insignificant predictors, backward, forward, and so on. Also, you can do by blocks. You can go to the next block and then do the multiple regression that way. Consult the textbook for more information on how to do those methods. But for now, we're just going to click OK and look at in the end at how these other predictors fare. So for example, percent of families living below poverty level, which was the first predictor that we used, still is significant. But the other two that we added, SNAP percentage and unemployment percentage, are not significant. Okay, so we can't say that these two added to the power of prediction. We could probably have seen that right over here in the model summary, where the R-square is about 25%, which is not much more than what we had in the beginning. And in the beginning, we had about 23.1% coefficient of determination, and now we have 25.4%. So it's about an improvement of only 2% overall. So those two variables did not really make a good predictor in terms of finding out the violent crime rate. If these two predictors were significant, then we would have constructed a more complicated regression formula, which would have added the X1, X2, and X3, respectively, for the variable 1, 2, and 3 that we used as predictors. So this concludes the regression in SPSS video. I hope you enjoyed it. Thank you for watching.